jumping on those cars, that's when they would cable you off. Because they're going now 40, 50 miles an hour and skidding around, and I'm on the hood of a car. Don't do that. Question.
Okay, if I'm the one to start us off, first of all, Shabbat Shalom, Mr. Shatner.
Shabbat Shalom?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. My Shabbat average was 250.
My question, just start us off already on a weird note, is I had...
Already on a weird note, yes. By talking to you?
Yes.
Or what I was talking about? What's the weird note?
Here's the question.
Oh, that's the weird note.
I have a comedic friend who made a whole joke that you would be the best Baptist minister ever.
I am! Heal yourself and ask a weird question.
First of all, congratulations and thank you for 50 years of Star Trek.
Thank you.
Yeah!
Okay, that's weird enough.
But all the fans appreciate you all these years hanging in there and doing all that you have, but you've had your hands in so many things.
I know, and people have complained.
You know, actor, director, comedian, is there anything that you would like to do, maybe in the future?
I walked down South Collins Avenue last night, and wow, there are a lot of things that I would like to have done. Oh, wow, I'm telling you. Well, there's a GoPro here. I recognize that. Look at the angle. It's a camera right here. Now, I sort of direct sometimes. Think of the angle. Is that a GoPro angle or what? Yeah, sometimes you get a crop shot like that in the head, and then you, what would I like to do? Which brings to mind, what am I doing? Right? What am I doing? Okay, I'll tell you what I'm doing. First and foremost, were you here for Henry Winkler?
Yeah.
All right, Henry has become a buddy of mine. I knew him. Let me tell you a story about him. It's really beautiful. It's a beautiful story. How I got to know Henry Winkler and how I spent my summer. So, I've got an office in a building in San Fernando Valley, a busy area of San Fernando Valley, and, you know, I just burped up that steak, that Cuban steak. It's very flat. Second time around with this one, so. How I got to know Henry Winkler while I'm doing my summer job. So I got this office, and there are windows, and people pass by on their way into the building. They pass by this window. Mostly they can't see in because it's lighter outside than it is inside. But those people inside, like me, can see outside. So I'm doing whatever I'm doing, and I look out at some staff members. Henry Winkler. Henry Winkler's walking by my office. I know there's some casting offices and stuff there, and continue my work. So there's Henry Winkler going back out 15 minutes later. I run out the door. Henry! I sort of know him vaguely. Henry, what's this bell? It's gone in here. What are you doing? He sits down, and he says, "It's just a terrible audition." I said, "What are you talking about?" He said, no, I'm so depressed. I was up for a job, and I just did a terrible audition. I said, "Henry, you're a wonderful actor. You can't do a terrible audition. You might not feel right, but it has to be good." No, Henry, I'm telling you, I know things. I'm a director, I'm an actor, I'm I know, Tom, you're a talented man, and you couldn't have done a bad audition. You really think so, Bill?
I know!
Oh, well, I feel better now. And he walks out, and when he walks out, he talks about that moment, right? He was so depressed, and he left feeling good about himself. So, cut about a year later, Henry Winkler, Terry Bradshaw, George Foreman, and me, seeing Asia, called Better Late Than Never, August 23rd.
Not again.
NBC. He mentioned it, didn't he? Well, it's hysterical. First of all, you got Henry Winkler, right? My bucket list was this. Catch a pass from George Foreman. No. From Terry Bradshaw. Get in the ring with George Foreman and have Henry Winkler make me laugh. That was my bucket list. I'm fading back, have a catch pass from Terry Bradshaw. I caught a pass from the four-time MVP player in the Super Bowl. I caught a pass from Terry Bradshaw. I get in the ring in Thailand. I get in the ring with George Foreman. Now remember what I said about Harold Tanaka, eh? So I've got George Foreman, two-time heavyweight champion of the world, and Bob Gamaha! George Foreman tried to trip me. Oh. 10 years. George Foreman stopped fighting when he was 30. When he's 40, he said, I went back. I said, why'd you go back to fighting? He said, well, I looked around the table at all the Georges. He named all his children George. I looked at all the Georges, and they were all doing the same thing. They wanted to eat. That's why he went back into fighting. So he said, I went back to fighting, but now I had found God, and I had found, I wasn't a killer anymore. And now I was a better editor. So now, imagine what the camera's getting now. So now, I'm jabbing. And all those years of God and peace and religion fall away. And the killer inside George emerges. And he takes this massive fist, goes, whack! I fall back against the ground, my knees. And it was part of my bucket list. I fought George Foreman. I'm in September, 0G. A science fiction novel I think is really good. You ought to remember it and take a look at it. I'm over there. I'm over here. Yes, what's your question?
Hi, how are you?
I'm so good. What about you?
Nervous.
Are you good?
I'm nervous.
You're nervous?
Yeah.
Where do you feel the nervousness? Where? You feel it in here. Where do you feel it? In here. I think you can cough it just a little while. The odd drug, the figure, nothing like Cuban coffee. I'm telling you, Cuban coffee's where it's at. And I had the Cuban coffee 10 o'clock this morning. What time is it now? Yeah. It's 3 o'clock in the afternoon. How am I going to sleep? Are you nervous still? Have I made you feel, have I relaxed you by talking? A little bit. Okay, so some more. We're gonna work on you not being nervous.
I'm ready.
Okay? Take a deep breath. Right into the microphone here. Now sing the national anthem. Okay.
Okay.
So first what do you get?
Oh,
say go.
Oh, say.
That's much better. How do you feel now? Worse.
I just said that.
Okay. What's your question?
It's a comment.
What?
It's a comment.
It's a comment, comment.
Comment.
And a question.
And a question.
Okay. And which is which?
The comment is first.
The comment is first.
Yes. When they killed you off as Captain Kirk.
Yes.
I was crying.
Me too!
Did you
flesh.
Have fun?
No,
was your last, you had fun? Your dying
word? Did I have fun?
That was your dying
word? Dying?
Dying?
No, dying's not fun. Dying is very, I think dying is better. I don't know. I suspect dying is painful. I don't want to die. Remember that when I'm dead, okay?
Okay. And my question is, would you have rather been left in the Nexus, or do you like the way they ended your character on Star Trek?
Left in the Nexus. Left in the Nexus. What the hell is left? What's left in the Nexus? What does that mean? What is the Nexus? Is that the next thing? Or is that us against the Nexus? What is Nexus? What is your definition of Nexus?
The ribbon.
Is what?
The ribbon. When you wear the ribbon back in time.
Oh, you go back in time. I'd like to go back in time. Wait another 100 years. I'm with the horse. I'm with the horse.
Yes.
Now. Yes. In the Nexus, I'm with the horse. That's not bad company. My wife might object, but hell, that's a great horse. Would I rather be in the Nexus, or would I rather be dead? I had a book called The Return. I had written a book on how to come back. I said, hey, I'm dead. Here's how I can come back. I said, no thanks.
I think it was a shame.
You read it. It's pretty good. It's good. It's good. Is it better than what? Yes. What did you say? Abort. Abort? Abort.
Reborn.
Abort. Yes. My pleasure. Thank you so much. Are you having fun now? Yeah. Right. Yes, sir.
Hello, Mr. Shatner. It's like...
Wait a minute. Right into the microphone. Nice and loud. Lightly.
It's a pleasure to be here and like speak to you. I'm really interested in what you thought about filming the first on-screen interracial kiss and what aftermath you had to deal with.
The aftermath of the interracial kiss.
Yeah. I'm sure it must have been like difficult to go.
No, it must happen. She's a beautiful lady. Beautiful lips. Somewhat moist. Slightly parted. I gently brushed her with my own mouth. Inhaled her fragrance. Tried to press it a little harder, she resisted. I gave up immediately. I was very kind and very gentle.
Respectful.
She liked that. And that's it.
Yeah, that sounds about right.
It covers the surface of a whole sexual moment, but this is a big crowd and there are kids here. Otherwise, I'd go further. Science fiction seeks to explain dark matter, the time travel, UFOs, life on other planets, species that are not carbon-based. We don't know anything. We know nothing. Quantum physics has taught us that we know nothing. There's such weird, strange things that as vivid as the imagination of science fiction writers can be, doesn't come close to what we're looking at, peering at around corners that science is showing us. How weird. How strange, how beautifully wonderful the universe is. Science fiction attempts to explain it in imaginative terms, and it forms a sort of mythology, which is what we're all doing here. Like, wow, isn't that strange and wonderful? the Greeks, 2,500 years ago, 3,000 years ago, discovered large bones that we now know are dinosaur bones, but they have no explanation. So they made a mythology, they made a story that explained the bones. They said there must have been a race of giants, and they must have lived over those Olympus mountains there, and maybe the gods and the giants fought, and mankind was in war, and they had a whole mythology trying to explain dinosaur bones. Science fiction is trying to explain the dinosaur bones of today, and that's what we're all doing here. Thank you very much. What a nice time.